That means we need to step into the life that Jesus Christ died to give us. So we step into that life today, Lord. We want to become a living sacrifice to you today, holy and pleasing. That we would use our life as an act of worship. That our attitudes would be an attitude of worship. Our words would be flavored with love and worship. That our thoughts, Lord, would begin to align today with your thoughts about us, about our situations, about our relationships, about our hurts. You're good, God. We thank you for the promise that as we call on your name and as we come to meet with you, you're here. You're here to meet with us. You never leave us. You never forsake us. We confess, Lord, today, we need you. I need you every hour. I need you every minute. Because the minute I step into doing it in my own strength and in my own way, Lord, I lose focus. I lose my perspective. I lose the ability to walk by the power of your Spirit inside of me. Because I'm trying to do it in my own strength. I'm trying to solve things in my own wisdom. So I just put my trust in you today, Lord, to know that you're directing my steps and that you are perfecting everything that concerns me. Let's say that today. You are perfecting everything that concerns me.
Everything that concerns me.
That's Psalm 138:8.
So I'm going to tell you what kind of day you're going to have today. Are you ready? This is out of Isaiah 58. By the way, he had me read Isaiah 4 times through and write out all the things that he was sharing as I went through it last year. Didn't know why. And now, it's like everything that is coming through, like seek God for the city, every scripture almost that they put at the beginning has been out of Isaiah. You notice?
Yeah.
And it's like, and that's what the Lord showed me. He said, this is like the Old Testament gospel. This is all about Jesus, all the way through. So here's the kind of day he says to have. In fact, he even uses that language. This is the kind of day that I want you to have. A day to set people free.
Yeah.
Yes. Come on. Yes.
I want a day that you take the burdens off of others. I want your day to be when you set troubled people free, and you take those burdens from your own shoulders. Amen?
Yeah.
I want you to share your food with the hungry. I want you to find poor people who don't have homes and bring them into your homes. When you see people who have no clothes, give them clothes. Don't hide from your relatives when they need help. I thought that was kind of a funny one. If you do these things, your light will begin to shine like the light of dawn. Your wounds will heal. Did you hear that?
Yeah.
Let me say that again. If you do these things, if you have that kind of day, your light will begin to shine like the light of dawn. Your wounds will heal, and your goodness will walk in front of you, and the glory of the Lord will come following behind you. Then you will call the Lord, and he'll answer. You'll cry out to him and he will say, here I am. How many of you want to hear God tell you that today? Yes. Here I am. I'm right here with you. Let's have a great day today.
Yeah.
Amen.
You are the one who brings me hope. Your love never let me go.
So the first 10 days, we fasted from negative thoughts about ourselves. And then the next 10 days, we fasted from negative thoughts about our circumstances. And for these last 10 days, we fasted about negative thoughts and concepts that we've had about God and false representations of God. And so this is the last day, this is day 30, of us fasting from negativity about what we believe about God. And so today is about joy and about laughter. And that God invented it. It says here, faith and medicine is kind of our theme today. We certainly believe in divine healing and divine health. But if Jesus had a doctor around him, well, Luke, then maybe it would be good if we did too. Here's a big post I wrote last year about the medicine that God is prescribing us. Imagine being prescribed medication and the pharmacist says, take this 3 times a day for 10 days and you will get better. Most of us would start taking the medication because we would believe that it would work. This is faith. And mixed with medication, it has helped many to get well. Dr. God has given us a prescription that has tremendous potential for our strength, health, energy level, longevity, and mental clarity. And it's called a cheerful heart, a merry heart, a joyful heart. Those who heed the great physician and mix their faith with the joy of the Lord will start on a wonderful journey towards vitality and life. Some would object and say, well, that's fine for you, but I'm not a joyful person. In response to this, please consider 2 things. First, can you imagine someone saying, I can't be loving because I'm not a loving person? What would we say? We would say, that's ridiculous. We are commanded to love God. God would never tell us to do something that we could not do, according to John, 1 John 4:7 through 11. The same principle holds true for joy. Each of us has the power and ability to become abundantly joyful. It is a muscle that can be developed in our lives.
Amen.
Second, this writer was entrenched in a joyless state that resulted from an it's not my personality belief. Instead of using God's word to create my identity, I was using my past and my experience to tell me who I was. As I share in the book Possessing Joy, which I've talked about, it's written by Steve Backlund, I was delivered from this bondage and my joy was increased dramatically, and it can happen to you too. Dr. God is telling us to take our good medicine. He is urging us to make joy and laughter a big part of our overall plan for good health for our lives. This spiritual truth is supported by science and recent medical research. So let's take our medicine. We won't be sorry that we did. Notice what the first 2 fruits of the Spirit are. Love and joy. Love and joy. First 2 fruits that we're supposed to produce from the Spirit being inside of us are love and joy. I think that there's something here that we need to grab hold on to. I think all of us would agree that we need to be loving, right?
Yeah.
We would all say that everything that we do, especially in the name of God, and especially if we've been commanded to do something, God says love one another. And so we're commanded to love, but we're also commanded to rejoice and be joyful. But so many times we've let that be circumstantial, and we've relied more on happiness rather than joy, because happiness is, we're happy when things are happening the way we want them to. And so that makes us happy. But when we're joyful, James tells us that we can be joyful even in the troubles, even in the strife, even in the hard times. And so that's where we need to. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Let's declare that. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Again, the joy of the Lord is my strength. All right, so here's the lie that we're going to fast from today. And you can laugh at it if you want. That God wasn't really serious when he said a merry heart is good medicine. That's ridiculous. So let's say this together. God is the great physician.
God is the great physician.
And he tells me.
And he tells me.
Exercise it. And so there used to be this song back in the 70s and 80s that we used to sing. It was called The Joy of the Lord is My Strength. And then you would forcefully laugh as a way of practicing and getting the laugh muscle going. And so I think that we need to sing that today. And so we're Let's do it in G. Here we go. The joy of the Lord.
Staff meeting and we pray. Or other people's attitudes or other people's actions have that effect on us. I
to recognize that we actually carry the kingdom of heaven. And the kingdom, there's nothing that can stand against the kingdom of heaven. And so that as we walk in love and joy, Lord, we're actually releasing and changing the atmosphere around us. And we don't have to be subject to the attitudes and actions or other things that are coming off of other people or circumstances. And that we would stand, we would take a brave step into your goodness, into who you tell us that we are. Thank you. Champion of heaven, you made a way for all to enter.
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
For giving us a place that's filled with love and filled with joy.
Amen.
When I'm missing somebody, I'm missing Caitlin.
Yeah.
She's still part of the family.
Yeah, she is. She hasn't gone anywhere. She's just overcoming in her body.
Okay, then. Lord, that's your job.
Right. Yeah. Amen.
And bring her back tomorrow.
Yeah, amen.
You can't live without her.
Amen.
Well, every one of us was created by Him, and we all have a job that He wants us to do. And we can do it a little bit, or we can do it in extreme. That's the Yahoo life.
Right.
Amen.
So, as I was reading through here a few days ago and got into Kings and, you know, went through David's trials. David was the second king of Israel. He's the one that none of the other Israelite army wanted to go against the giant, and he says, what do you mean, God's with me? He just picked up his slingshot and got his stone and ran after the giant and then slayed him.
Yeah.
And one of his sons is Solomon. And that at near the end of David's life, Solomon become king. Now, Solomon loved the Lord and followed all the decrees of his father David. He was humble and he had a heart for God, like his father David. And then one night, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream. And God said, what do you want? Ask, and I will give it to you.
Come on.
Solomon replied, you show faithful love to your servant, my father David, because he was honest, true, and faithful to you. And you have continued your faithful love to him, to me, by giving him a son to sit on his throne. Now, O Lord, my God, you have made me king instead of my father David. But I'm like a little child who doesn't know his way around. Where am I in the midst? And here I am in the midst of your own chosen people, a nation so great and numerous they cannot be counted. And this is Solomon's request to the Lord. Give me an understanding heart so that I can govern your people well and know the difference between right and wrong. For who by himself is able to govern this great people of yours? The Lord was pleased that Solomon had asked for wisdom. So God replied, because you have asked for wisdom in governing me with justice and have not asked for a long life or wealth or the death of your enemies, I will give you what you asked for. I will give you a wise and understanding heart, such as no one else has had or ever will have. And I will also give you what you did not ask for, riches and fame. No other king in all the world can be compared to you for the rest of your life. And if you follow me and obey my decrees, my commands, as your father
David did, I will give you a long life. Then Solomon woke up and realized he had been dreaming. He returned to Jerusalem and stood before the Ark of the Lord's Covenant, where he sacrificed burnt offerings and peace offerings. Now, sometime later, two prostitutes came to the king to have an argument settled. "Please, my lord," one of them began, "this woman and I live in the same house. I gave birth to a baby while she was still with me in the house. 3 days later, this woman also had a baby. We were alone. There were only the two of us in the house. But her baby died during the night when she rolled over on it. Then she got up in the night and took my son from beside me while I was asleep. She laid her dead child in my arms and took mine to sleep beside her. In the morning, when I tried to nurse my son, he was dead. But when I looked more closely in the morning light, I saw that it wasn't my son at all." Then the other woman interrupted, It certainly was your son, and the living child is mine." "No," the first woman said, "the living child is mine, and the dead one is yours." And so they argued back and forth before the king. Then the king said, "Let's get the facts straight. Both of you claim the living child is yours, and each says the dead one belongs to the other. All right, bring me a sword." So a sword was brought to the king. Then he said, "Cut the living child in two and give half to one woman and the other half to the other." Then the woman, who was the real mother of the living child and who loved him very much, cried out, "No, no, my lord, give her the child. Please do not kill him." But the other woman said, "All right, he will be neither yours nor mine. Divide him between us." Then the king said, "Do not kill that child, but give him to the woman who wants him to live, for she is the real mother." When all Israel heard the king's decision, the people were in awe of the king, for they saw the wisdom God had given him for rendering justice. And goes on, "During the lifetime of Solomon, all of Judah and Israel lived in peace and safety. God gave Solomon very great wisdom and understanding, and knowledge as vast as the sands of the seashore. In fact, his wisdom exceeded that of the wise men of the East and the wise men of Egypt. He was wiser than anyone else in that was living at the time. His fame spread throughout all the surrounding nations. He composed some 3,000 proverbs,
right,
and wrote 1,005 songs. He could speak with authority about all kinds of plants, from the great cedars of Lebanon to the tiny hyssop that grows in the cracks in the wall. He could also speak about animals, birds, small creatures, and fish. And kings from every nation sent their ambassadors to listen to the wisdom of Solomon. Now, He became and had a Wahoo life. Mm-hmm. I guess until he had too many women, but he had to have a lot of wisdom for that. But each one of us has a life and a journey that we're on.
Yeah.
Right.
Good. And God is asking, what do you want me to do for you?
Amen. Glory.
And your answer can make a big change in how the rest of your journey is. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus.
For our journey.
Amen.
We'll be with you soon.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for sharing that heart. So, what do you want? Let's go out today with that on our mind. And what are we asking God for? What are we pressing in? What are we believing for? And allowing, yesterday we talked about the prophetic promises that God is speaking over your life. These are connected to your life verses and ways that you've encountered God in the past or even now. And what he's speaking over you, and there's truth and promises that he wants to connect to that for you to step into everything that he's created you to be. So let's go have an awesome day. Amen.
Jesus.
Amen. Bless.
Thank you. strong without the